This is the story of American freedom. There was an air of anticipation, even urgency, in that sultry late spring of 1776 in Philadelphia. The delegates that had come from all 13 colonies to discuss the great question of independence from Britain. Attitudes had changed tremendously since the summer of 1775. At that time, there was still very strong opposition, even among leading political figures in the colonies, strong opposition to declaring independence from Britain. But now, with blood on the ground at Lexington, with the siege of Boston, the question had simply become too strong, too pressing to put aside. Thomas Paine had argued in January of that year in one of the most influential little pamphlets ever written that common sense demanded separation from Britain. Britain, he said, why do we need her? You say she is our mother country? Well, that's great, but should you still be living with your mother when you're 50 years of age? You say that Britain has protected us. She has protected us because we are wealthy. She gains from us. She would protect Turkey for the same reason. No, we are already a great nation. Let us simply declare our independence from Britain. It is common sense. This had changed the minds of many Americans. George Washington, leading the American army, pressed for the need of declaring independence from Britain. Without such a declaration, we are nothing but rebels. Any ships that we commission are pirates. We must understand why we have taken up arms. And when this spring came, a majority of the state legislatures, which had chosen the delegates to the convention in Philadelphia, gave them the leeway to vote for independence if it seemed in the good of the state and of the common good. And so the debate was taken up. And already on June the 7th of 1776, Richard Henry Lee, whose descendant would do his best to tear apart that union, Robert E. Lee, Richard Henry Lee put forth a resolution that these colonies are and of a right should be free and independent states. Now you notice the use of the word states, for this was not the independence of the United States of America, a united country. It was of each individual state. And as any proud Virginian will tell you, more than a month before, the state of Virginia had already declared its independence. So you keep this in mind. You right there, keep this in mind. The states were declared independent. They existed as states before they existed as a united nation. So he put forth his resolution, and immediately the delegates, presided over by John Hancock, a leading revolutionary figure and a very wealthy merchant, appointed a committee, small committee, to draft a statement that would declare to the world why these United States were declaring their independence from Britain. Among them were Thomas Jefferson and John Adams, Richard Livingston, Roger Sherman, and the wisest delegate there, as he would be at the Constitutional Convention 11 years later, Benjamin Franklin, renowned in Europe as a scientist, a politician, a diplomat, who had long pleaded the cause of the colonies before Parliament. So they sat down, working there in Jefferson's small rooms. Now, you've got also to picture, these are not congressmen with huge staffs, big salaries. They got their expenses and nothing more. They did not rent out whole suites of rooms. Working there, a little tiny set of chambers, working on a special little writing pad that he had made for him by a carpenter and that he would leave to one of his descendants. There they began to put together this draft to declare to the world their reasons. Jefferson wrote it. He was the youngest. He was 33 years of age. One might have expected the rotund and bald John Adams, pompous as he was with his Harvard education, to write it. But no, he wanted Jefferson to do it. He may have been fat, but he was a shrewd politician. And if there were going to be any blame to fall on this declaration as it came before the Continental Congress, well, let it fall on Jefferson. Nobody made many amendments or changes. And then it was composed by Jefferson. And then the question came, are we actually going to vote for independence? Some of the staunchest revolutionaries, men like John Dickinson, who had been for the cause of freedom since the very beginning, from Pennsylvania, was cautious, skeptical, and he warned that such a breach would destroy any support that the colonies had in Parliament. And indeed, throughout this long revolutionary struggle, there was an important faction in Parliament led by men like Edmund Burke, who opposed King George III, his cabinet, and supported the cause of the American colonies. In opposition to these strong voices of caution were the pressing military and political necessities. As Washington urged the need for this to be an independent country, fighting as an independent nation under the rules of war, so also was the clear recognition from the beginning that these colonies, fighting against the most powerful navy in the world, the best army in the world, the greatest financial power in the world, and indeed a Britain that was determined to crush this revolution, there had to be foreign aid, intervention, above all by France. And King Louis of France was loath to support a bunch of rebels and cutthroats. And thus the debate went on day by day through June. And then Jefferson presented to the Congress his Declaration of Independence. John Adams had made a few additions. The delegates at the convention made a number of changes. In fact, Jefferson got more and more angry as they kept changing his Declaration of Independence. But finally, it was agreed upon, and on the 4th of July, the delegates stepped forward to begin to sign it. John Dickinson remained opposed. And as late as July the 2nd, there were those who were opposed. Pennsylvania itself had a majority in opposition to this Declaration of Independence. South Carolina was opposed. And above all, Delaware, that small but vital little state, was split right down the middle. But on the 4th of July, the delegates from Pennsylvania, who were opposed to the Declaration of Independence, stayed home, all of them but John Dickinson. Benjamin Franklin implored him, but Dickinson said he was not opposed to independence, but the time was not opportune. South Carolina declared that in the interest of unanimity, they would go along, for this had to be a unanimous declaration. But Delaware was still split right down the middle. Two delegates were present. A third, Caesar Rodney, was at home in bed, sick with the flu. And the delegate from Delaware who was opposed stayed right there in the convention. He would not leave. "I will vote against this," he said. This he had done on the 2nd. Word had to be brought to Caesar Rodney. He got out of his sick bed, rode all through the night, more than 80 miles, arriving there in Philadelphia to sign that Declaration of Independence. And so it was done. Don't let anybody ever tell you that it was not signed on July the 4th. That is something that historians like to make up, that it was an elaborate process and it wasn't actually signed. Well, John Hancock knew better when he scrawled in his big, bold hand his name, saying, "I wrote it so big that Georgie won't have to put on his spectacles to read it." And late in life, John Adams and Thomas Jefferson both swore that on the 4th of July they had signed this Declaration of Independence. Now, are you telling me that Jefferson and Adams would lie? But even more than that, old men, their doctors declaring that they would die very soon, both Adams and Jefferson hung on until the 4th of July of 1826, and then, having achieved that glorious anniversary, both passed away on that day. So it is a momentous day in the history of freedom, a momentous day in the history of our country. But what was the Declaration of Independence? Our course is called The Story of Freedom in America. We need to pause for a moment and decide what we mean by freedom. For much of our trouble in the world today comes from a serious failure to understand the meaning of freedom. Freedom, as we normally use it, actually consists of three separate components. There's national freedom, there's political freedom, there's individual freedom. And these three ideals of freedom are not mutually inclusive. National freedom is your freedom from foreign domination. It is perhaps the most basic of all forms of freedom. The second is far more rare. It is your freedom to vote, political freedom, your freedom to hold office, your freedom to serve on an honest jury. And then thirdly, there's individual freedom. That is your freedom to live as you choose as long as you harm no one else. Now, in this country, we have achieved a unique balance of these three forms of freedom. National freedom. We have never been conquered. We cannot imagine it. Political freedom. You are more free politically here than anywhere else in the world. You know, I don't get upset when people say, well, only 30% turned out for this election. So what? That means that we are so secure in our political freedom that we can take it for granted. Then thirdly, there is individual freedom. Freedom to live as you choose. That includes economic freedom. It includes the most basic freedom of your lifestyle. You are more free individually here, again, than anywhere else in the world. I suggest to you that thousands of people are not swimming the Black Sea tonight to try to get to the Ukraine. But thousands are coming here because they believe and know they will be more free to make a better life for their family than anywhere else. So we have achieved this unique balance. And we tend to forget that other countries may not want this balance. National freedom. North Korea, that is a very good example of a modern nation that has national freedom without any political freedom, without individual freedom. It can be argued that Germany and Japan never truly knew political freedom until they had been conquered and lost their national freedom by the United States at the end of World War II. Ancient Sparta is a clear example of a strong national freedom, strong political freedom and democracy, and an absence of individual freedom. Now, we have three great charters in this country. The Declaration of Independence is our declaration of national freedom. The Constitution is our charter of political freedom. And the Bill of Rights is our charter of individual freedom. So it was began the moving paragraph of the Declaration of Independence, when, in the words of Jefferson, a decent respect for the opinion of the world declares, maintains, that we express the reasons why we are separating from Britain, dissolving the political bonds that have held us to Britain for all these many years. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal and they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, among which are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, and that governments are instituted among men to secure these rights, and that when a government becomes destructive of those rights, it is not only your right, it is your duty to rise up in revolt. We hold these truths to be self-evident. Don't let anyone ever allow his or her eyes to glaze over at these words. They are the most profound statement of independence. For America is the only nation in history founded upon moral values. How did you get to be an Englishman in 1776? You were born there. A German will still tell you, in honesty, that you are a German because you speak German as your mother tongue. But we say, come here from any place in the world. Speak any language as your mother tongue. You are an American because you accept our principles. The law of nature. America is founded on the ideal of natural law. That is the idea that goes right back to Athens and the first democracy in history in the 5th century BC. It goes back to Rome, and one of its finest definitions is in the Roman patriot, Cicero, in the 1st century BC. Natural law is the law of God as revealed in nature. Now, the Declaration of Independence clearly states a belief in absolute right and absolute wrong. Liberty is absolutely right. Tyranny is absolutely wrong. And you can only believe in absolute right and wrong if you believe in God. Now, that's not a political statement. That's just looking at it from the point of view of 1776. Now, we today don't accept that. As a society, we don't believe in absolute right and absolute wrong. Don't you believe that it's a situation that determines whether something's right or wrong? Yes or no? Tell me. There's no such thing as lying today in our society. To the founders, yes, a lie was wrong. But today, are there just levels of truth, levels of lies, and all that really matters is not being caught in a lie? So belief in God and an absolute right and wrong stands at the very foundation of the moral principles upon which the United States declared its national freedom. And the Creator, God, who gave natural law to the universe and endowed all humans with the unalienable right of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Oh, what cliches they sound like to us today in our wisdom. Life, though, it stands at the very center of a debate so divisive in our country today that we are afraid to discuss it. When does life begin? Liberty, how would you define it? Well, most of you would raise your hand. Do it, raise your hand. I think you would define it as the right to live as you choose, as long as you harm no one else. That's how the founders defined it. Aha, but there's the rub. When do you start harming somebody else? Secondhand smoke? Not wearing your seatbelt? There. So we as a society still do not understand and agree upon what makes you impinge upon the rights of another person. And the pursuit of happiness. Oh, one of you wise people is going to raise your hand and say the cynical Jefferson really meant property. Well, first of all, that's not a bad thing to mean. Cicero, talking about natural law, believed that you can have no true freedom unless there is a respect for property. And he, like Jefferson, believed that you have an unalienable right to property. An unalienable right. That means you cannot give it up. You cannot throw it away. But he didn't write property. He wrote The Pursuit of Happiness. And that means you have a moral obligation. This goes right back to Aristotle. And indeed, Aristotle was cited by Jefferson as one of his sources, as was Cicero. You have a moral obligation. And happiness, true happiness, is fulfilling your moral obligation. And that obligation is to live your life in such a way that you leave the world a better place. And governments receive their power not from a king, not from a king who has gotten his power from God, but from the consent of the governed. This was truly a revolutionary idea. 1688, Parliament had fought for that right to have the consent of the governed, and now the Americans were proclaiming it to the world. They no longer believed in a parliament. They believed that they, these colonies, now states, had the right to determine the consent of the governed, of themselves. And that when a government becomes destructive of these rights, then it is not only your right, it is your duty to overthrow it. And so that powerful first paragraph, establishing this country, its charter of national freedom upon moral values, absolute right and wrong, and however unfashionable it is today, upon a belief in God. Then followed a set of grievances, ways in which King George, and this was a document, this was a propaganda statement to convince the world. And you convince people best by centering all the problems on one person. So George is the real bad person in all of this, and ways in which he had violated the natural law and rights of the colonists, starting with small things like interfering with where their legislatures met, substituting his arbitrary will for law, and then going on, subjecting them to a foreign jurisdiction, parliament, then reaching a crescendo of having it declared them outside of his protection, of burning their towns, of raising up insurrection among them. Such a behavior is unworthy of any prince who would be ruler of a free people. It is indeed a tyrant and his actions. Thus they declared that these united colonies are and of a right ought to be free and independent states. And to this we pledge our lives, our fortunes, and our sacred honor. These were men trained in the art of rhetoric. They knew that saying three things, a triad, was the most memorable way of making a statement. And so they pledged their lives. They also understood that the last of these triads is the most important. Their lives, yes, they wanted to live. Benjamin Franklin remarked quietly, you know, we'd better win, because if we don't stand together, we're surely going to hang separately. And Elbridge Gerry was spoken to by John Hancock. Elbridge Gerry from Massachusetts, a skinny little man. Hancock said to him, "You know, when George hangs us, I'm going to have it a lot better. I'm big and fat, and I'm just going to go boom. But you, you're going to dangle there like a fish on a pole." Their fortunes meant a great deal to them. But the third of this triad is the only one to have a qualifying adjective: our sacred honor. And to them, honor was not a word. It was a whole complex of ideas that expressed your very being, your very substance, your moral worth. It was your integrity, your bravery, your magnanimity. And that was sacred. It is no accident that one of these signers, Button Gwinnett from Georgia, would die on the field of honor in a duel. And so, pledging their lives, their fortunes, and their sacred honor, they started out on this dangerous course of independence.
The Story of Freedom in America with Dr. J. Rufus Fears is made possible by the generous support of our Freedom and Heritage sponsors. The Story of Freedom in America is a program of the Institute for the American Constitutional Heritage at the University of Oklahoma, in partnership with the Alumni Association of the University of Oklahoma. For more videos and podcasts, visit freedom.ou.edu.